Hello and welcome to Your View, and thank you for joining us. I am Moriah Afolabi Brown, and I have my incredible co-host here with me. Hello, ladies.
Hi.
Hello, YK in the building. Yo. Looking nice and grey.
Thank you.
Very Tuesday-ish, you very hospital doctor health issue kind of.
You know what? Every morning before we start the show, I'm always eating groundnuts. And when we start, I try to finish
before the show starts. You try to gulp it down, especially when it's stuck in your mouth. I know that feeling, trust me.
Meanwhile, tomorrow is Timothy's birthday.
Who is Timothy?
Our
floor manager.
He told you.
Okay. Don't worry,
he says, you are on tomorrow because I'm not on.
I'm greeting him ahead of time.
Happy birthday.
In advance. How are you doing, Waike? How was your weekend?
Fine. A bit tiring, but fine.
Yeah. It looks like a very, very tired Tuesday. Even I'm just tired. I'm still booting as I am right now. How are you doing, madam?
Nima is fine. The mosquitoes came knocking.
Mosquitoes, yes. Yeah, so.
They came in full force, and I don't know who left the door open, but I couldn't sleep throughout the night.
That mosquito net.
In fact, I have. But you know, we have our regular gate man likes to go out and come back. And, you know, she will just keep going and coming. I don't know why, but last night I just kept hearing them. It was already late, around 1 a.m. I had to sit down and try to.
There's a cream I use for my children. I won't say the name.
Mosquito repellent?
Yeah, the mosquito repellent.
You can put
once you know that you have mosquitoes, at least you get your net stuff to set it up, just put it on your body and they're okay overnight.
And this is not the time for mosquitoes to be biting anybody.
They are customers. Look at my legs.
Look at the state. I was going to mention.
Goodness. Look at my legs.
Your legs are not looking sexy at all, though.
They've beaten shege in my body.
Ah, that's terrible. Okay.
Look.
Where's that place you live again? Just kidding.
And it's lucky that they're biting me.
it's lucky that they're biting me.
My thigh is here.
Have more swamps in Lekki anyways.
Yeah.
Water here and there.
That's true.
How are you doing, Joe? Okay.
I'm very well. I'm a little saddened this morning with the Boko Haram attack, up north. And seeing gory pictures of children burnt yesterday, I just couldn't deal with it, you know. Imagine being a parent and seeing, you know, your children go through this. It's put a damper on the beginning of the new month and week for me. But we're hopeful that, you know, all of this will be a thing of the past very soon.
Amen.
Yeah, I know.
Amen.
All right.
How was yesterday for you?
Fine.
You were all in hijab yesterday now.
Yeah, it was really nice.
I thought you were going to continue.
Honestly, I'm thinking of continuing, actually. I like it. I really like the way I looked yesterday. It looked really pretty. We might make it a Friday thing.
Okay.
Because interestingly, a lot of people, you know, we still need to bring this hijab thing back. Because a lot of people, I've got the message that is you're showing that we can live together as Muslims, that we're supporting the hijab. Some said, oh, you're a Christian, you shouldn't have done that. Why would you wear the hijab? You know, it's not a proper Christian thing. And I'm wondering, hello? Are we supposed to be living together?
And then
religious
it's
tolerance.
It's a piece of clothing, I mean.
I'm saying, how like, terrible. If you live in Saudi Arabia or one of these countries,
how terrible can
would you not say that? Oh, because
when we go to Dubai, we all wear their, you know, and we feel cool in it.
It was really embarrassing. Right? People actually said, somebody said, to talk, but
people always
really
talk.
Saying that, you know, they're really disappointed in her for wearing that, that as a Christian, she should have. And I'm wondering, that's so low.
You know, people always have an opinion, you know. You have to sift through the ones you listen to.
You can't please everybody.
I agree.
We must learn that in life, that you can't please everybody. You just live your life the way you believe is the right way.
And when your hijab doesn't make it less of a Christian.
Your conscience is clear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fine.
That's fine.
All right, so we might be doing hijabs Fridays. Let's just...
You might. I'm not.
Well, I'm speaking for myself.
I'm definitely not.
All right, we'll take a quick break. When we come back, we'll look through the front pages of the newspaper. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Let's start with the punch. EFCC raids former Vice President Sambo's office in Abuja, carts away inventory of properties, asset declaration form. Buhari must reclaim Nigeria from corruption, says Uwais and Gambari. Picture here of a little boy and some others in Honduras. That's concerning the Zika virus, trying to get tested here. Tompolo begs court to vacate arrest order. $620,000 bribe. ICPC rearranged for Faruk Lawan today. Lagos female driver crushes 8 persons to death. AKT, APC to AGF. Prosecute Fayose, others for rigging. Governors live like emperors. Divert council funds, says Obasanjo. Jonathan bought refurbished, expired weapons, says federal government. All right, so lots of stories. Let's pick about two or three stories
can
here.
Can we do the human angle?
The human angle.
Yeah,
yeah.
We all read it.
Okay,
let me quickly establish. So this lady going home in Bariga, Elijah Bariga, she stopped at the filling station. She was being driven and her driver got down. You know how maybe your driver's house is this way and then you say, I can drive myself the rest of the way. Anyway, she gets into the car. Some people think it was a failed brake, but immediately she gets into the car. The car jerks forward and then she hits passers-by. In fact, the next morning they were finding dead bodies in the gutter.
Two dead bodies they found in
the gutter. She was almost lynched. She was beaten by...
And they found her. This, they
yeah, she was still in the car, you know. She was lynched. She was almost lynched. She was beaten. Mm. But
the police stopped them from lynching her.
From lynching her.
Oh, wow.
It's very sad.
It's very sad because, you know, I think three people... The story varies. It's
there was a pregnant woman amongst
them. But the police said she wasn't pregnant, that she had fibroids.
Ah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I
don't know how they knew.
They said she appears to be pregnant. That's what they said.
But she has fibroids.
Okay. Well. All right, let's pick another story. Jonathan bought refurbished expired weapons, says federal government. Elijah Lai Mohammed was saying that.
That was the exchange. You know, President Jonathan, when he was in Geneva, had come out to say that, you know, they're fighting the Boko Haram war that they're winning with the equipment that I bought just before, you know, before I stepped out of office, and they were delivered after I stepped out of office. And then, you know, the Minister for Information in his usual style is saying that the ones that you bought that are, you know, expired and bad. But, you know, there's credit to what he's saying because the Chief of Air Staff, that was, what's his name?
Amosun,
that was, you know, charged recently, was found to have bought
second-hand
aircraft. With, you know, the price of new aircraft.
But there was an argument that if our president is saying that we're winning the war technically, how is that? Does that mean that what are they using to actually win
exactly.
the war
technically?
That's
the question, that's the question left open, yes.
Yes, because we haven't heard that they have bought arms.
Exactly.
So they must be using arms that
Jonathan bought. So maybe Alhaji will help us respond to that because everybody's asking that question,
Alhaji is not actually saying that they have bought weapons or that it wasn't Jonathan's weapons. He's just saying that don't come and take credit that we're winning this war. The weapons you actually bought were even losing human because he said some of the you know, the bomb throwers, they are loaded from the back and that they will now explode and even kill the person loading it.
Yeah.
So don't come and take credit. That's what the information
Let's quickly take another
saying.
Story. The $650,000
Faruk Lawan.
Finally. How many years?
It's coming back, you know.
How many years now?
I can't remember.
2014. That was when the lady,
The judge stepped aside.
Okay. That was because
he petitioned the Chief Justice that, you know, she had issues of what's it called?
Credibility because she's friends with Otedola.
So, you know, and she, even though they investigated and found that there was no credibility to what he said, she decided that, you know, there was something against it. He had attacked her integrity in some way and decided to step down.
She stepped down in 2014, but since then nothing happened.
But so now the case actually happened in 2011, because I remember it was right after the subsidy protest.
So we need to see the end of this.
We will see.
Now that ICPC has brought it back.
It's very, very important.
All right, moving on to the Nation. PDP chief, my life at risk over Ekiti poll fraud leak. Let me read this quote from Aluku. I was later made to understand that the fake security agents were actually miscreants, acting on the orders of Ekiti State Governor Ayodele Fayose to get rid of me at all costs. I have made a resolution to let the whole world know what happened, what transpired. Now, Fayose, in his response, says he is somebody that can harm himself and blame it on any person that he hates. He should be ignored. We don't know what happened to him and we don't care about what happened to him because he is a person of questionable character. Those are the quotes. Let me finish all the other headlines. EFCC searches ex-VP Sambo's Abuja's office. Uwais Gambari Buhari's corruption war on course. All right, so let's talk about this PDP chief, Aluko.
Dr. Tokpe Aluko said that after the interview at Channels Television that on his way out around 9:30, some security officials stopped his car and said that, you know, they had order to arrest him. And that, fortunately for him, he called insiders at the IGP's office and they said there was no such order. So he fears that those people were miscreants sent by the governor of Ekiti State, Ayo Fayoshe.
Well, it's not interesting how, because we know Ayo Fayoshe, if he really wants to throw something at you, he will throw something at you. But he hasn't really said anything really, really aggressive against this guy.
I don't doubt Aluko, because the same Ayo Fayoshe denied, after getting thugs to beat a sitting judge in Ekiti State, denied that they were his thugs. So,
and then the same Governor Fayoshe also mentioned that the voice that we heard in the military tip, Ekiti Gate, that did we hear that he was even telling them that he's not happy with what the military is doing? He denied, you know, all the allegations thrown at him. He always denies them.
This is still pretty fresh.
So, but look, Dr. Temitope Aluko is a prime witness. Yes. He needs protection.
Exactly.
Excuse me. I was listening to the TVC news this morning, and a lot of the tweets were, this man, they should go and arrest him for perjury.
Yes.
That's because, what she was saying.
Yeah, because if he's saying that he knew and you didn't talk, it is not that he suits you because he didn't favor you. Yeah.
Exactly.
You too.
So I think he would have thought about all these things before he even came out, because there's no way that you will come out with this kind of information and expect that you wouldn't be prosecuted also. So I think he's ready for the worst case scenario.
Not only that, he didn't talk. He was prime witness in the case
against election petition.
He was, as the PDP secretary, he was prime witness. He denied under oath.
Exactly.
That anything happened.
Yes. So obviously, I'm sure he has considered all that, knowing that, listen, I'm not going alone.
So as to whether he's credible or not now is a very big issue.
Okay. Let them first of all carry him and then get all the evidences that he has.
Yes. All right, let's move on very quickly to, we didn't talk about EFCC such as Vice President Sambo's office.
It's in the other paper.
Okay. Vanguard. My fears for Buhari's change agenda, says Obasanjo. Doubt if current administrative system can implement change, says gains he made in public service reforms reversed. Senate uncovers 10 billion naira hidden in education budget. Very interesting. I won't speak on the $2.1 billion probe now, says Jonathan. Why I did not pick Aluko as my COS, that's chief of staff, says Fayoshe. And $2.1 billion arms probe, EFCC rates ex-VP Sambo's office. All right, let's talk about the other interesting
Sambo
stories.
And
President Obasanjo.
10 billion.
Obasanjo, there's 10 billion, there's Jonathan, there's Fayoshe. So many stories.
Let's start with Obasanjo. He gave the President Buhari's team a vote of doubt at the Institute for Governorship, whatever, that, you know, this former Commonwealth secretary is now chairing. He said that he doubts that with the caliber of people surrounding the president, whether this team can actually carry through this agenda of change, that he is disappointed that, you know, he fought seriously to get waivers of our debts by the Paris Club and all that, and that those legacies have been reversed. Everything, and, you know, corruption everywhere. He also indicted the government.
Maybe that's why he was asking for the third term, because he realized, you need like a dollar.
He wanted to push it.
He wanted to see how he can actually help us.
That's another matter.
Maybe that's why he was.
That's another matter.
Is he a messiah?
He also indicted our governors that, you know, they are living in luxury land, asking the citizens to sacrifice.
I passed Obasanjo's house the other day. I nearly fainted. A person's house is as long as from there to there. If you see the house.
You don't have access to live in state funds now.
Excuse me.
Does he have access to state funds?
He
did. He
live in glass
houses. He did.
When he was president,
he does.
See, when you live in glass houses, don't throw stones. That is my own.
Certainly.
Please, this Senate finding 10 billion hidden in education
budget.
That's a serious issue. And I'm happy that they're able to bring out this story, because they were asking questions. These things don't add up. How come there's this 10 billion? For the parastatal law,
what they did was that they increased the personnel cost for the parastatal, education parastatal, but decreased the personnel cost for the actual universities and unity schools. So for your own Bayelsa State, you have 10 billion naira increase in personnel cost. Well, the actual people you're supposed to be overseeing, that the schools and universities, you now decrease their own money. So that's what that's the 10 billion.
The Senate is asking the right questions to say that we're saying austerity, austerity. All of us should tighten our sugar too. How come you people are still inflating budget?
The minister couldn't defend it.
They couldn't defend
it. That they're actually really dissecting.
The PEMSEC was able to.
So
we've not seen this in a long time.
We are dissecting with them.
They are really dissecting this budget, you know. You just see their Tinubu, Remington, they're like, they're saying, this thing doesn't favor women. We are struggling, we voted for change. I'm like, they're really, really.
Morayo, this the Ministry of Women has been given 4 billion in that budget. What will 4 billion do when only the presidency has 39 billion?
When only our ex president's wife, remember last time, she was going to build her. One thing for 4 billion naira. That's somehow.
Plus, one person was going to use 4 billion. Then you give, and then when you wanted us to vote, you came to us women. So I suppose Senator Tinubu on this one, that Nigerian women are not happy with this government.
They're not happy with this. Okay, so let's move on very quickly to the Daily Sun. Arms deal, EFC raids ex-VP Sambo's office. I think we talked about that.
No, we haven't.
Okay. Obasanjo hits governors. You are emperors. Shettima sets up tax force on feeding in IDP camps. Budget scam uncovered. Senate discovers 10 billion padding in education budget. I was under pressure to stop presidential poll, says Jonathan. And Father Mbaka opens up on meeting with Buhari, Jonathan's wife. Yes. Let's start with Father Mbaka, or we want to go with him.
Yes, so
Vice
Father
President.
Mbaka. Okay. They've removed him from that place where he is now.
His former parish. There's not another parish.
And he is saying it is punishment. They're making him suffer. It is punishment. And the bishop, the spokesman for the bishop is saying, no, it's not that anybody can be moved, any minister can be moved from one parish to the other. And in fact, he is going to a ministry. So he, in fact, it's more like a promotion, not a demotion.
Well, the article I read, which I thought, yes, at the time where he was moved, it seemed as though he was complaining that, oh, I'm going to suffer. But the article I read now, the reporter went to meet him. He had his mass at Adoration Ground, which is very close to his new parish. And he said that's why he's going to be having his Sunday services every Sunday for now, until things are completed with his new parish. And he has lots of equipment that he's moved. He doesn't have where to keep them yet. But so far, he thinks everything is all going okay. And it was going on and on about the whole scandal that happened with Jonathan
Father
and
all Mbaka, the Catholic priesthood is like military service. Don't worry, you'll be okay.
Starting a new parish is a lot of work. I know that. I'm aware that within the Catholic, when you go to a new church and you're starting a new parish all over again after you have developed one, is a lot of work.
Maybe he did a good job where he is.
They want him to do it somewhere else.
Anyway, I need to mention this point that I read. He said, listen, he didn't collect one cover from ex-president Jonathan. When the wife came, she paid an offering, and then there was serious money in the suitcase for him. He returned the suitcase and even the offering, the one that was for God, and that carry your money, that he didn't collect one kobo. That everything he said it because he was revealed to him that he has nothing. So nobody can say that he collected anything from Jonathan.
But he said he asked for a number, Sha.
He asked for a number, but they gave him some Kenneth's number because he wanted to be giving them the prophecies directly, the ones he gets instead of putting on new papers. But since they didn't give him, he was there.
Okay.
Moving on, our last paper for this morning is this day. Adeosun Amaechi in spat over absence of directors at China Exim Bank talks. I hope you guys read that. That was really interesting.
I read it.
EFCC raids Namadi Sambo's office. 900 billion naira debts. I'm going to publish names of recalcitrant debtors tomorrow. And Jonathan bought substandard weapons. This Adeosun matter. Who read that?
I read it. It was just a small fracas. She
was not for
she,
I heard that she really, really gave it to
she left. She left
in
Nigeria with Emirates, and then he was coming behind. And when he got to the airport, her own team was supposed to meet at the airport, was supposed to leave that afternoon
with Amici's team.
He got there and saw a contractor,
on the list that wasn't
and
there.
They said, he's not there, so nobody traveled, including him. Nobody traveled. So while she was in China now, waiting for her team, she had to go and meet the China Exim Bank
by herself.
And so when he got there, and she found out that was the reason,
She was like, no, you can't do that.
Yeah, yes, now. If you want to delay your own team, delay your own team. But not my own team. You should have let them come. Because he was saying that, oh, the contractor didn't show up. That this name was not in the list. He cannot fly with us. So nobody's going anywhere. Like, don't try that with my own team. Please, girlfriend was giving it to him.
Yeah. All right. Okay, quickly, before we run off, VP Sambo's residence and office was searched. Yeah. And the reason EFCC gave was that they had mentioned his name in the $2.1 billion arms deal. They found $50,000 that has been seized. And they're saying that in his statements, Metu, for the former PDP secretary, mentioned that some of the monies paid to him from the National Security Advisor, Dasuki, came through Sambu's office.
Okay,
that's all.
So that's all we can take.
Okay, that's all we can take because I needed to say something there.
No, let's move on because we run out long run out of time. All right, that's all we can take on Front Page. When we come back, resident doctors want compensation for families that died of Lassa fever. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Now, according to reports, the National Association of Resident Doctors have appealed to the federal government to compensate the family members of the deceased doctors and other health providers who lost their lives to the deadly disease during the outbreak of Lassa fever in the country. Should these families be compensated or not? What are your thoughts on this? You can call us on 070-80-66804. You can tweet to us at TVC Connect. Please hashtag your view TVC so we can read your tweets. All right, yeah, compensation. Some are saying, is it still not too early to start asking for compensation? Or do you think it's appropriate to be asking for compensation at this time?
I think that the amount that they get for incidents is 5,000 naira is too small. But then again, for the risk that they face, I don't think that even they protect themselves enough. You want to take, as I walk into the hospital, you want to take my blood pressure, you want to take my temperature. You don't protect yourself. You don't wear no gloves. Now, if you find out that my temperature is 100 degrees centigrade, at that time you realize that there's something wrong with this person, but you probably already have touched me. You know, so you're at risk of contacting whatever it is that I have. I've seen that happen many times in many hospitals. So they expose themselves a lot also. For people,
but should doctors or health workers be demanding for compensation? Because the truth is that shouldn't it be a given, really?
Can I say
or something?
Yeah. Because I've noticed that this country, doctors, and I will call policemen, firemen, they do not receive compensation, adequate compensation for their should
kind
be
of work they do.
Yes, for the work they do, they should, because if you're in the Western world, if your person dies on active duty, for life, that family is taken care of, the school fees, everything. They will hear. That's why you see policemen, arm robber is shooting you, like they are running like this. And you can't blame them. Because if they die, who will look after their family?
Well, that reminds me of then what our government is trying to do with the taxes. Let's say we're trying to tax people because over there it's taxpayers' money that does these things. Now we tax our people to be able to meet these kind of needs. But if we want to tax them now, they say, oh, don't tax us. We're already suffering. I went to see the Honorary Commissioner of Tourism last week, and there were lots of us at the waiting lounge to see him. And so he came out and said, my meeting plans just kind of mumbled, jumbled it up. Let me just say, okay, you, Mariah, I'll see you in a few minutes. You know, I was trying to sell time. He now saw some two women. And I said, you guys are family. I don't see family during work hours. Go home, because these are taxpayers' money I'm using to meet people. They're here for official matters. You go home. Family matters, we deliver women to get to the house. And I was really impressed. Like, okay, so this is somebody that recognizes taxpayers' money. So if the government is asking for taxes, it's because they want to use them for these kind of services of compensation, of making sure that our health workers, our police. So we shouldn't be so adverse
to that plan of tax. Tax talk until we pay tax before we get development. We've been there. We've wasted money. We had oil boom. Can we just start to see maybe a start? put things in place, maybe when they are just starting, and we know that the tax that you want to collect now will continue to develop this thing, not until you get these taxes. You see, I have been there. I've seen it all. When it comes to fire service, Nigerian policemen, and military men. Now, I don't know too much about the medical, but I know that when you don't have proper welfare packages for your workers, that is what you get. My dad had to leave Ministry of Works, Federal Ministry, and move to NNPC because of proper welfare packages. And I'm thanking God now that he retired from that place, because if he had retired from the Ministry of Works under the Federal Fire Service, my father might not have this proper pension that he's getting today.
But healthcare packages, let's be fair, is a bit different from compensation. Compensation is that you get my healthcare package is different. Compensation is just...
Compensation
is 5,000. I mentioned that already.
Because you demand compensation when you know that you don't have proper welfare. Now, if you work and nothing happened, there was no accident throughout your work years in any establishment, and you're entitled to some kind of pension that you know, I have served and I'm entitled to this. Yes. There will be this level of contentment. Now, if you now finally get an accident and you know in your contract package, or you've seen in a convention in that workplace that at some point in time, you're entitled to this if this kind of accident happened. Someone, a friend of mine, her dad died while trying to put off a fire. He didn't even, the accident, the injury he had from that hot wall falling on him was what killed him after 7 years, because he had to carry that injury for years. There was no package, and they were the ones funding the hospital bills. Now, these are exceptional cases. Even if they don't have that, when the government sees these exceptional cases, can they just put emergency things in place and let people be motivated to take these jobs? We have a lot of graduates who are not even looking into fire service, who are not looking into police. People are running away from these places because of this kind of packages.
My auntie was a matron for Island Maternity for years. She died 10 years ago. 10 years before she died, she was struggling to get her pension. She died. She did not get her pension. Her family did not get that pension. Do you understand? Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Now, we are talking about the tax. Some of us are already paying
tax. Yes, workers,
tax.
Yes. And we're seeing some of the developments already.
Listen, you might say the tax we are paying is not adequate, but whatever we are getting, the returns that we are getting is not adequate.
It's not even proportionate.
It's at all.
It's not proportionate.
So, and NEPA will still bring the bill and not give you light.
And then the issue of taxes, YK. Go ahead.
I just wanted to finish there. So you go on.
Sorry.
Stop my train of thought.
The issue of taxes is that it is a minute amount of people. There's gross unemployment in Nigeria. You want to overtax the few people who are already paying taxes. Company income tax, personal income tax, VAT. There's taxation on everything.
Everything. If you sneeze, you pay tax.
You understand? So rather than put your budget to such that 50 to 60% of your budget is capital expenditure, such that more people are getting a tax bracket. So more, because there are 170 million Nigerians. If all of us are paying 1,000 naira per month, that's a huge income to the government.
So they should sack everybody and just transfer that budget to capital.
It's not about sacking people. When the people are putting 10 billion into their own budget, when they are not even thinking of getting teachers to do the job.
All right, let me take Ismail. Are you there?
Hello.
Usman from K2. Go ahead, please. Usman.
Hey, good morning. Where are you?
Good morning.
How are you and family?
Very well. Go ahead, please.
Okay. Nice to see you. I just want to ask of Tope.
She's not in today.
Hey, yeah. My regards to her.
Yes, sir. All righty.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
We have some tweets. Tope is tweeting. Health workers should be compensated, but not from demand based on Lassa fever or Ebola. It should be the norm to be compensated. Now, happy birthday to Mrs. When the fight against Lassa fever is still on, compensation call condensed knee.
Think about it. I'm working in a TV station and I have to work overnight because there's a concert going on. It's part of what I paid for. That's the reason. It's part of what I was being, I'm being paid for, to work late night. Now, as a doctor, there'll be cases like this. That's what you signed up for as being a doctor. So if you're being taken care of, there's a given that you have a proper welfare package. Now, we know that's not the reality here. Mm-hmm. But in case where you have a proper welfare package, does the issue of compensation still need to come to the fore? Nope. Because the truth is that other parts of the world. Yes, these doctors are not compensated. They are giving a proper welfare package.
Then to remain, it can remain the discretion of the government in power.
So our push therefore should be for a proper welfare package for these people.
I think that if Ebola comes into town, and because we have never had Ebola, person who takes a fall for that should get some extra compensation.
Or volunteers.
Which is what they give them 5,000 naira for now.
Volunteers can get compensation because even abroad, if you go and volunteer for these kind of things, because you are a volunteer, they will give you something.
Yeah.
But if you are you're hired to do that job, you get your own separate payment, which is your regular salary. Or
and
your
I just wanted to help you out on the tax matter. I have to bring it up.
Yes,
because I remembered what I was going to say. My grandmother, when she was before she lived in Nigeria, she lived in England and she was paying tax. She came here and she lived here from 61 or 63. 63, she left here in 2002. When she went back to England, she got her pension. She got her pension because of the tax she paid. Now, let me tell you, all of us here will not collect no pension, even though we are paying tax when we get old. That our own is development pension. It's development tax. It's not for to help us in when our own future old. When we are old. Do you understand? That our old age, all of us will be begging if you cannot work.
All right.
And if you have not saved. So, I can't blame them.
They should pick up the likes of Abdulrashid Min, all these pension thieves that,
have
taken a lot of money.
All right, hopefully, start from there. We just want to
compensate them, Jerry.
Now that there's a Zika virus going on right now, more people start running. God help us. All right, let's take a quick break. When we come back, Zika virus. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Yes, welcome back. According to new reports, there's a new virus spreading in South America, and it's been documented in the United States, but only among travelers. It's called the Zika virus, though no case in Africa or Nigeria yet. Zika virus is a mosquito-borne virus. It causes mild symptoms of fever, rash, joint pain, and eye redness. The virus may pose a risk to pregnant women. Anyway, joining us on the show is the practitioner, Dr. Tuyi Mebawondu. I got that right?
Yeah, but it's okay.
Yeah, welcome to the show, sir.
Good morning.
Mebawondu. Welcome to the show, sir.
Good morning.
To give us your view, you can call us on 070-8066-8014. You can tweet to us at TVC Connect. Please hashtag your view TVC so we can read your tweets also. So we know it's not in Nigeria yet, but we have plenty of mosquitoes here. So we want to find out that are we at risk of this virus?
Absolutely, we are at risk. Because just yesterday, WHO just declared Zika infection as a global epidemic, with special interest. What that means is that when you declare a disease as a global epidemic, with special interest, what it means is that we need to mobilize resources from everybody, every country, because, they're actually, taking a cue from the Ebola virus, which everybody was criticizing them for not, rising to the occasion sufficiently on time. So, now they've quickly done that. Of course, you can't fault WHO, you can't even fault people that are making noise about Zika virus. It seems to be a mild infection. Yes, it's a mild infection. But look at it. Do we now want to have a next generation of stunted people without brain? I cannot take decision. So how is it going to be like that if you now have a whole 5 years or 10 years of delivering babies that are not properly, that the brains were not properly developed? So what are we going to do? So, and then secondly, the modus of transmission is still being, we're still studying it. Can it be transferred to the baby inside the womb? Can it be transferred sexually? And then we don't even know the evolution of the virus, what is going to come up next. That's the thing. That's why it's necessary for us now to stand up and try to find out what we need to do. Yes.
Excuse me.
Yeah, yes.
Mosquitoes have been biting me seriously.
Is there any way to know whether it is the Aedes mosquito or the Anopheles mosquito? Because I don't get malaria, so I will not know. So,
Aedes is the vector. Okay. Taking the virus to human takes the virus from somebody who is infected, because 80% of the infection are asymptomatic. You don't really have anything.
Yeah.
So the virus picks it from somebody who has the virus and transmits to another one. The mosquito, I mean. So the special mosquito picking it is called Aedes.
Mm.
That's the species. So again, how do you differentiate this mosquito? You might not be able to differentiate the bite, but you can differentiate the mosquito. You always see that black and white stripes on the legs and the body of the mosquito.
Uh-huh.
That's one thing.
Black and white stripes on the body and the legs of the mosquito.
Then secondly, this mosquito would not probably go to bite you at night. Early in the morning, in the evening.
Ah.
It's a day eater. So and actually a very voracious day eater. So now for us, what do we do?
Yes.
What do we do? We've been fighting infection. Let's face it, we're fighting infection every time. We had an Ebola. Before we know it, a Lassa fever came. Now we have a Zika virus. Now, the challenge is for us is to, rightly, we need to sit down and rethink, you know, the threat to humanity. Yes, if you take extremists, I mean, all those people killing people everywhere, if you take climate problem, infectious disease come very next in terms of threat to life. Human existence.
Hmm.
And for us, we need to sit down and look at how do we deal.
That's the virus.
Yes, okay. That's
the
black and white.
I think
about this one in secondary school.
So it's important that you know we should do.
This one is.
That's the mosquito.
That's not the virus.
That's the Aedes mosquito.
Yeah, the black and white thing. You know, distinguish that.
Hey, Lord Almighty.
But me, I wear glasses, so how will I see it? Whether it's black and white.
You see black and white.
Anyway,
but the. Yes. Yeah, the key thing is this. You will look at the environment, okay? Look at us. We don't have a proper sewage system.
Mm.
The soak away is always hanging somewhere at the back of your door, at the back of your house. And then you have the broken things, you know, the broken soak away. That's a good place for them to breed.
Mm.
And then you also see a lot of water, you know, collecting somewhere, either inside a small container or somewhere there, or inside in a shell.
Or gutter,
that's another space. And we see our gutters, everything open.
Mm.
So this mosquito have that leeway to breed and grow and become whatever you know they want to be. So for us, it's important to sit down and honestly rethink our environment.
Mm.
You can't shortchange the ecosystem. We need to honestly take charge of our environment and look at it.
What are the effects of the virus? Now, the virus has bitten somebody. What does it do? What are the cause?
80% of people will not have any problem. They'll just keep, maybe just a mild weakness, and then they'll go about their way. You say, well, I'm just tired.
Mm.
Okay, but in the 20%, of course, like you already pointed out, the fever is there. Okay, like all viral illnesses, the rash is there, joint pain, and then conjunctivitis, redness of the eye.
So redness of the eye.
So those are the key things. For the virus, it may not actually go, you know, to cause major problem. The problem was the fact that it was found out that the virus can cross the placenta and can be picked in the amniotic fluid and then lead to shrinking of the baby's head.
Aha.
Now, because there's a normal size for the when the baby is born, there's a normal size for the head when you measure it from at the level of the face down, at the eyes down. So there's a normal size, it's about 34 centimeters normally. Now, any baby that's only less than 31 is having a problem.
Yeah.
And of course, when the brain is not developed, there's a lot of issues okay. When the brain is not developed.
So you said that the mosquito is just a vector.
Yes.
Now that this virus normally lives in humans and the mosquito will pick it from, you know, that from a bite and take it to another person that is not infected. I want to understand it all.
Mosquito, the virus resides inside mosquito without any problem.
Okay.
Mosquito gives it to human.
And then take it again.
And then take it again and trust.
Aha.
So now when it's in a human being, how long is that, you know, that at the point of biting and how long does it last in the human system? Or how long is our immune system supposed to, you know, clear it?
Yeah, because again, most of these viral illnesses is just, you know, a few days to about 1 or 2 weeks. You know, before you now start having
this fever.
But the main challenge is this: when the virus is in the body and it's asymptomatic, you know, most viral illnesses or viruses that stay in the body may not cause problems and they're just there, not causing any problem. So now when the virus is inside the body, what now happens is that, and the woman now gets pregnant, for instance. We've not studied the effect of the virus even on the production of germ cells, maybe the sperm, whether it's going to affect the sperm. It's a new virus. Yes, it was in Nigeria in around 1967, first isolated in Nigeria in 1967, but that was the end of it. Now, a lot of these viruses just mutate, change their shape, change their structure, and become more aggressive as it is. So when those viruses in the body, when it now crosses to women's to a newborn baby, that's when it causes most of this problem. And even later in life, it can cause some other symptoms, really restricted and damaging to the brain.
One question.
Okay, the question I thought she was asking, I think, is if the mosquito bites her now and she gets the virus, how long will the virus stay in her body before she's now like
the Ebola, you know, Ebola was 21 days incubator.
Not the incubation period.
Not the incubation period. Most viruses stay in the body and create, you know, your body breeds the immune system against them. Most of them actually stay there and they may just be dormant and not cause any problem.
Because like if a woman who is not pregnant gets it, how long before she can get pregnant?
That's a big picture of a baby that has
Zika virus.
And that, you see, that head is small. That head looks big to me.
No, it's small. It's small. Look, you measure from look at it. The cap.
Look at the cap. Okay.
It's shrunken. Okay. You know, reduced.
That's true.
Unlike the normal head. If you saw a picture of the normal head now, you're able to appreciate that. Yeah. Well, this one is a microcephaly.
So there's a higher risk between mother to child than just person to person, because for person to person, it can actually be dormant and nothing.
It can just be there.
The moment it's mother to child, that's when you have this kind of...
That is the association of between microcephaly or small head and the virus.
I was in a question of, it hasn't arrived in Nigeria. What do we need to do as a government and a people to prevent this?
I think, honestly, let's look at intervention at three levels, personal level. We need to be able to take charge of our environment and try to get rid of mosquitoes as much as possible. But I don't know why the government cannot take that ambitious or aggressive duty
to fumigation.
Eradicate mosquitoes. It's doable. I remember... it's doable, yes. You know,
fumigation.
It's been done in many places. It's just consistent fumigation. Close your gutter, consider fumigation and that awareness. You know, so I think it's very, very important. Now, I think in the last few years, it was being done in Lagos, and I'm sure maybe along the line, they're trying to do that fumigation to reduce the load of mosquito, because it's not just only Zika virus. There's so many diseases that mosquitoes transmit, dengue, chikungunya, and all those yellow fever and cold, you know. Yeah. So we need to honestly look at that at individual level. Then we need to rethink our sewerage and sewage system. You know, and even the way we store water. I mean, at individual level, we must take charge. If you're pregnant, take that initiative to sleep under
mosquito net.
I mean, what is the big deal? You want to sleep under
it's
mosquito
hot.
Net. You know, mosquito
sleep
net has
naked
perforations. It has perforations.
It's very, very hot. The mosquito goes and hides in one corner.
What the nest does is that actually it has chemical that actually can kill mosquito. Okay. So it's not just about, you know, the net alone.
Let's take a quick commercial, but when we come back, let's take some tweets, all right? Stay with us, we'll be right back. Welcome back. All right, let's take some tweets.
General Castro says, Nigerians shouldn't relax just because Zika is not in Nigeria yet. We better start researches now. Tosin Tade says, this disease shouldn't be taken lightly. Better ready than late. Al Ibrahim says, all those Western countries develop a lot of virus in the sense of humor.
All right, we'll take some more tweets, but let me take this call from Jude. Jude, are you there?
Yeah, my name is Chudi.
Chudi, go ahead, please. Chudi.
Okay, I think the earlier government actually sits up and begin to do something positive, the better. Because now the country, whether we like it or not, the awareness is building up, but action needs to be taken. We are too theoretical in this country. We are to carry a lot of papers around. We are talking and talking, But you discover that nothing comes out of it until suddenly we begin to see these things happen in Nigeria. We begin to see women delivering babies with such deformities. Then everybody will begin to scream, where is the Ministry of Health? Where is the President? What is the Presidency doing? What are the state governments doing? I think the Ministry of Health, the current minister, needs to really, really seriously drive this. Awareness is important, and he must involve it from the local government to the state government, straight down to the federal level, so that every stakeholder needs to be involved. This is a very serious matter. If it comes to Africa, if it comes to a country like Nigeria, we have a lot of population. We're in a bigger situation.
Thank you so much.
All right. More tweets.
Yes, please.
M.M. Adiola says, the size of a mosquito alone is something to worry about. Please, doctor, how do we fight these mosquitoes this season? Priscilla was saying, how many health workers can volunteer for this cause of public education without pay? Should we take more?
Yes, please. This one I want to take. Morning, ladies. Please ask the doctor if repellents can counterattack the mosquitoes, if the mosquitoes' effect on pregnant women.
Yeah, sure. We need. You can actually, I was coming to, individual taking, action at individual level. Apart from taking care of the environment, a pregnant woman should sleep under
mosquito net.
And then, when you are in a place that's endemic with mosquito, you need to actually, get repellents and rub on your body so that, those day bites will be prevented.
Are the repellents okay for pregnant women? They say they have too many chemicals in them.
No, you can use, there are repellents that's good for the body. It's not,
okay, let me take this call from Kingsley, really. Kingsley, are you there?
Good morning.
Good morning, go ahead, please.
Kingsley,
sorry, I didn't get what he said. I know the PACFA, I can't remember the full name of PACFA. They deal in health, mother care, child care, and all that. And they came here recently, I think last week, with a few other agencies. And they were saying that the current budget concerning health, that the federal government wants to build additional health centers.
Okay.
And they're wondering, we already have 10,000. Why don't we actually invest that budget in this 10,000 already existing to improve the healthcare systems across than building additional buildings? Now, because the truth is that, what I'm trying to drive out is that the budget actually should be more effective in actually helping to curb diseases, to help to increase our facility than just building infrastructures across. But do you agree with that?
Yeah, you're very right. Because again, let's face it, what makes a health institution? The quality of human resources in that place. It's not, for instance, if I choose to bring a lot of good human resources into this place, people will get good health. Yeah. Okay? It's not the building. I don't care how beautiful the building is. I don't care the numbers. Mm. Okay? The quality of health workers in that place, and it makes the difference in terms of delivering health benefits to the people. So now, I don't just, the issue of the budget will be overflogged because, again, you look at it, it's actually a far cry.
Let me take this call from Abdul Karim. Are you there?
A far cry from what we need.
Good morning. Good morning. Go ahead, please.
Good morning. How are you?
Very well.
Yeah, my own comment over this, you people are talking over health issues. Yeah, it's very important. But my own view of point of what I see over what is happening, this enlightenment is very, very progressive to people that live in the area that televisions are working. But our main problem, when you go to the remote area, some people, they are just using radio to hear news. And no proper publication or something like that to those that are living in the remote area. So please, we are calling on the federal government. Let them move their hand to local government so that sensitization will come very close to people.
Sure.
Like people that live in the area that these cases of Boko Haram, which one that are you going to face among the Zika or whatsoever the virus? That's my own comment over this, please.
Thank you.
We are thanking TVC with the progress of doing all this.
Thank you so much.
We have to pray for you people.
Thank you, Abdulkari.
Donate money to them.
Thank you, Abdulkari. More tweets, please.
There's one question on Twitter I'd like you to address. He said, can continuous body cleansing. I mean, I'm sure it meant detoxification. Can it, you know, help fight this virus?
I think I'm trying to run away from that. I think, honestly, in one of my researches, or, you know, work is studying abroad and all that, so it came up, you know, germs are always with us, ready to. Not, they don't really, maybe we can't see the high potential of killing us, because there are a lot of beneficial germs both in the soil and the human body. But here we are, along the line, there's a kind of conflict. We see them as enemy, we need to fight germs every now and then. When we fight, we win a bit, then these germs come back, mutate, and become more aggressive and start killing human beings. So for me, I think generally we need to rethink this concept of, you know, fighting relating germs. With germs. Let me use that word, relating with germs. Mm. And then, secondly, human body needs to get a new version, however that was going to be, either in terms of a proper immune booster, either in terms of, you know, vaccines for areas of diseases, because, again, we can't stay here and every time be crying, germ is coming, germ is coming, germ is coming, you know. We need to rethink not just the health system, we need to rethink even the body system, how the body...
So stop over-sanitizing, yes.
You know, if you know how to detoxify, if you detoxify, probably you weighed off the germs for some time, they will mutate and that one will come back.
Sir, do we have treatment for Zika virus for in now, Nigeria?
No, even anywhere, no treatment anywhere. What you can do is a conservative, you know, care, you know, just to ensure. Like, the preventive measures is what we've atomized. That is what we need to emphasize.
No.
And the fact that, you know, women should actually, you know, if you're coming from a Zika endemic area, for instance, you're coming from Polynesia or coming from South America, or you travel there, I think we need to do a special check on you. It's not, even the screening for Zika, it's not a cheap thing because it's a PCR thing. Chai. You know, it's a PCR, you know.
Okay,
it's
we have to round up. So, Wagyu, you want to quickly
October says, please read Matthew 24, verse 1 to 51. These diseases are talked about in the Bible. This mosquito will just touch you and you start scratching.
But there was one advice that the WHO was giving, that women who come from these areas that have the Zika virus now shouldn't get pregnant for a month or two months. Do you agree?
Absolutely, until we understand exactly how to deal with this virus, because that is where we are now.
So this is a new virus that we don't even have a clue how to deal with it. So I still do. Ebola came. I can't eat bushmeat. What's the other one?
Lassa. You can't eat gari.
There's another one again. This one has come now. It said that you have to
don't get pregnant.
Don't get pregnant. I have to stay under the head. This is where. Jesus Christ, come soon, I beg. All right, that's all we can take on the show this morning. We'll see you again tomorrow. Have a lovely day. Bye-bye.